place. It's one of the top places in international relations and worldwide. And I think it came top in the UK list or one of the lists. Who cares?
Our list.
It's a really nice department in a very nice place. Relatively far away from easy access to airplanes and things like that. So thank you, Patrick, for coming. I really was very interested in having this this more historical dimension into this wider reflection on concepts. As I told you probably many times, I'm a historian by training initially, and I still like to think of myself as a historian also. So it comes naturally to me, but I think it's also an important contribution to deepening and also dividing into more of a conceptual discussion, to take into account this more historical question. So I have begun to work on this wider subject of memory, you might call national politics or writing, with a specific focus on World War II. Yes, it's the monograph coming, Remembering the Road to World War II, which is a large scale comparative survey of the conflict and also the impact in terms of national identity and collective memory. This project of how the Second World War still shapes our lives, which is obviously pertinent to our discussion on transnational trends in the memory of the conflict since the end of the Cold War. He is one of the foremost experts in international history, as it's an important book on advanced in international history, which is a major contribution to the discussion.
Symbolic politics, which comes along with the topic of collective memory. I will say at the start that, as Bruno indicated, my perspective on these things is that of a historian, so to a certain extent I'm approaching this in a different way to the way that many of you are thinking about international politics, and equally the work that I'm doing and have done in the area of collective memory is not perhaps not directly keyed to the kind of problematics of regions, multipolar world, and so on. But hopefully, the presentation which I give you will provide some food for thought on those kind of topics, and perhaps we can explore those connections more in the questions. So, collective memory and international politics, then. The conceptual issues arising from the study of collective memory in the context of the study of international politics. And collective memory is a topic and issue which has emerged quite clearly onto the agendas of both international history and international relations in the last 10, 15 years. And this emergence has, as is almost always the case, intertwined roots on the one hand in kind of broader scholarly developments in the academy and in the as it were, real world of international politics, where issues of memory appear to have become much more salient in the last 10, 15, 20 years. So on the one hand, there are scholarly roots. Memory has emerged as an analytic category and a very powerful and prominent analytic category across the humanities and social sciences over the last decade or so. And we've also seen the the coalescence of a kind of discrete interdisciplinary field. Mandarin studies replete with its own usual scholarly paraphernalia of journals, conferences, international networks, and so on. So this is the emergence of a new scholarly field. And whilst that the emergence of that field can be explained in purely kind of intellectual terms in relation to intellectual trends, it's also clearly intertwined with the newfound salience of issues connected with memory, the representation of the past, the legacy and heritage and burden of the past within the political world. And there's many different aspects to this, which I'll go on to talk about in the course of this presentation. The emergence of a kind of symbolic politics around memory is, I think, incontestable. Of course, there's a kind of observer bias built into this. Because I'm studying this, of course, I see memory everywhere, and I see it being significant everywhere in a way that other people might not. But to me, it seems obvious. For example, as we saw yesterday in Greece, the first official act of the new Prime Minister of Greece was to lay flowers at the National Resistance Memorial in northern Athens, a memorial that commemorates the massacre of 200 mostly communist resistance fighters by the Nazis on May Day 1944. So, you know, he didn't have to choose to do that, that's his first act, but of course it's freighted with the whole kind of symbolic significance in relation to Greece's. Greece's, the challenge that confronts the new government in Greece as it tries to embark on delicate negotiations with Germany and the EU. Of course, that's not to suggest that the only thing that's going on in that political relationship is working through the legacy of the Second World War, but that's a crucially important frame through which the political process is understood by at least some of the actors. Secondly, building on that, you can see conflicts, disputes about memory, and in some cases quite distant memories, having become a much more prominent feature, I would argue, of international politics, particularly in the post-Cold War era. The wars in former Yugoslavia in the first half of the 1990s marked a step change in the visibility of how historic issues played out in interstate relations, and that's continued through the Cold War period, and I'll go on to say a bit more later about two kind of case studies, the East Asia kind of case, particularly the Japan and China conflict over history, and also Eastern Europe, the complex relationship between the EU, its Eastern European member states, and Russia over issues to do with the Second World War past and the communist past. So there are international disputes about memory, much more visibly now. And then thirdly, on a more kind of transnational realm, there's another kind of way in which in global politics issues of memory are played out and are making themselves felt. Again, since the end of the Cold War, one has witnessed the flourishing of new kind of norms of regret, apology, and reparation, which have been advanced by a whole series of actors, some state actors, but also non-state actors, and particularly prominently as non-governmental organisations and non-state actors have become much more significant over the last two decades. A new kind of form of transnational activism about memory issues, pushed forward by many actors in civil society, in connection with states. And you can see this, I would argue, I mean, today, the 27th of January is Holocaust Memorial Day, the 70th anniversary of the liberation of Auschwitz, and of course, if you look in the media, the kind of commemorative activity around this event is massive, and it involves all kinds of different actors within the political realm. So to a certain extent, scholarly interest in this is a response to its apparent increasing significance in the world. So in consequence to this, there's been there is evidence in the literature of growing engagement in both international history and international relations with the issue of memory. And in both cases, this builds on older concerns and older scholarship, but takes it in new directions and advances the exploration in new ways. International history, on the one hand, long-standing scholarly interest there in how decision makers deploy analogies in their deliberations, analogies to previous conflicts, to previous situations, to try to render unfathomable contemporary contingencies comprehensible, and how that deployment of analogies fits with a wider kind of ideational terrain in terms of the mental maps of policymakers and the kind of unspoken assumptions which they bring to bear in their thinking. So there's a long-standing traditional kind of scholarship that's interested in that. But this has been given new life and taken in new directions following the so-called cultural turn in international history over the last 10, 15, 20 years, where the role of ideational factors in international history has come to be taken much more seriously, and the issue of memory is one of the together issues, such as gender, national identity, and so on, is something which has been paid much more attention by scholars. This takes this traditional interest into new directions. Similarly, in IR, there is a longer standing, as it were, traditional literature about how policymakers think in time, to use Neustadt and May's formulation from their landmark book. But this has been taken forward in new ways as we've become sensitized to the theme of memory by these broader scholarly and political developments. And it's particularly being taken forward by scholars from the, how shall we say, kind of more critical end of IR thinking. So post-structuralists, constructivists, and also there's been some thinking about this in the sort of Copenhagen School kind of securitization frame, thinking about memory as memory linked to identity as part of ontological security of states, particularly of state actors. Now, flagging up the fact that this has mostly been a concern at the kind of critical end of IR immediately makes clear the fact that how far you're inclined to be interested in this kind of thing obviously will depend quite a lot on your pre-existing theoretical investments and so on. As Thomas Berger, who is a kind of constructivist fan of these kinds of approaches, has characterized it, from a more realist perspective, these kinds of issues are only ever going to be seen as kind of garnish, as sort of froth on the sea of where the real determinant forces are, the tides and so on. These kinds of things on the surface are not seen as really driving the politics and political change in a more realist kind of frame. So, I mean, that goes without saying, and to some scholars within both international history and IR, they're never going to be persuaded about the significance of this. So, of course, one just has to live with that. But I would argue that even if we're simply talking about the level of analysis we're interested in is just kind of agent-centered and so on, I think this is undeniably relevant to how states go about locating and decision makers and so on, go about locating themselves in the world, making sense of their own position in the world and their relationship to others, and I don't think you can deny that. In some respect, these kinds of memory issues are producing conflicts in international politics to which we should attend. So that's a sort of moderate kind of claim for why we should at least pay some attention to this. Partisans of memory studies, on the other hand, would advance a much, much stronger claim, as is evidenced in this quote from Alan Conf Fino. The argument from some partisans of memory studies is that you know, memory should come to serve as almost a new kind of master category for explaining the social, cultural, and political world. That it's so prevalent, it saturates people's consciousness, particularly in the contemporary world, but also further back, that we need to start to think about it as kind of determinative, almost, of other kinds of relations. And so in a kind of strong memory studies frame, this is inescapable, because this is central to human consciousness. I guess I'm going to put myself somewhere between those two kinds of extremes. We can discuss the relative merits of those two positions later, if that's of interest. But you know, for the purposes of today, my kind of claim is a sort of mid-level one, that this is, there's something going on here that can't just be disregarded, even if its precise significance at particular points in time, in particular relationships, in particular circumstances, cannot be assumed. It has to be interrogated in concrete kinds of cases. If we want to think about how collective memory works in relation to international politics, then, as I've written about elsewhere, memory studies literature, I think, provides new resources to develop our understanding of how memory matters, and how how understandings of the past come to function and come to have significance in international politics. So, as I say, there's a developing literature on this in both international history and IR. My argument is that the engagement with these issues can be strengthened if scholars in those two fields take on board much more seriously the kind of conceptual, theoretical, and empirical work that's being done slightly separately in the field of studies. And there are four key issues where I think we can see memory as being salient, as being significant, and where we can analyse the different kinds of ways in which memory manifested itself and the different kinds of work that it's doing. I don't want to talk about each of these in turn. First of all, decision making, policy making, kind of deliberation in a kind of conventional frame. Then moving outwards to talk about memory as a component of political culture and national identity. Then thirdly, again moving out to look at some specific cases of international conflict over memory issues, over the legacy of the past, the interpretation of the past, issues of responsibility for past crimes and atrocities, and then fourthly, to look at the kind of transnational dimension and how memory is playing out across state borders in a kind of with the emergence of sort of transnational webs of interaction and engagement. It occurred to me as I was in this presentation, but I should probably have done this slightly earlier to just talk about the way in which I'm using the term memory and the way in which memory is itself a profoundly contested concept. This is effective memory has become established as a term, even though it's simultaneously recognised by people in the field and outside the field as a slightly sort of problematic one, but it's just too easy to kind of use it as a signifier. Even though it always has to come with caveats and footnotes saying that it's a slightly problematic term. Some of the ways in which memory is seen as a problematic usage are listed here on this slide. There is a range of difficulties that come with trying to transplant a concept which originally is arises in the personal and psychological kind of realm, connoting to the remembrance of personal experience, into the collective and social realm. Nations, states can't really have a memory in the sense that a person can have a memory, but memories are now, whether that quite works to connote the kinds of processes that one is interested in when exploring the role of representations of the past within politics. Jay Winter, one of the foremost historians of collective memory, in fact, rejects the use of the term memory in favour of the term remembrance in order to, he says, to make clear that there are always agents at work here, that it's not memory, it's not just a thing that kind of emerges naturally, it's an artifact, it's something which is worked on and produced usually by particular people in particular contexts or particular purposes. By the same token, Joanna Burke has neatly encapsulated the point that we're talking here about something processual rather than something that simply just hangs in the air. And it's the process of remembering which is really what's important here. Similarly and relatedly, the common critique of memory studies is that it's simply obsessed with the production of representations. That you look at a film about the Holocaust, you look at a statesperson conjuring up a reference to some historical event in their rhetoric, and then memory studies scholars simply go, look how important this is. Of course, the next step is to explore, not just to kind of read representations, but to explore on the one hand how they've been produced and why, and also then to explore consumption, how they are received, how they are negotiated, how they are rejected by those at whom they are aimed. So there's a whole series of issues here, conceptual issues which need to be considered. At a very basic level, you can talk about what the study of memory involves in these terms that Confino again. As he puts it in an attempt to render this in a very simple kind of way, it's about the construction of senses of the past and understandings of the past through processes of often invention and appropriation, invention in the sense of fabrication, and what this means to the relationship of power within society. So we're focusing on the process whereby the past comes to be invoked or comes to be felt, and then relating that to the purposes, either explicit or implicit, overt or covert, by which for which that comes to be done, and how that relates to power relations. Okay, so as I said, there are four key areas really where one might see. Memory figuring on the political play in the political landscape, and the first of these is in the this, as I say, is the kind of most conventional level of analysis, decision making. So how policymakers use the past in their policy deliberations, how the past weighs upon them as they come to confront you. Contingencies and how they refer to the past and invoke the past in order to try to make sense of situations and to decide on their preferred course of action. Now, this is, as I say, this is built on a long-standing kind of very conventional sort of analysis of decision making and its rhetoric. And in itself, you know, this is not uninteresting. There are many different types of historical experience that can come to play in decision making, and that historical experience can be deployed or invoked in a lot of different ways. There's an article, I've got some references at the end, I'm just going to circulate this, I think. An article by William N. Bodeman, American historian and political scientist, that was in the Journal of Strategic Studies, which exhaustively kind of taxonomizes to different kind of ways in which the past can come into figure. He distinguishes between different types of historical experience, between where policymakers bring to bear experience of something, of experiences from their past, but that they've lived through, but didn't, but when they weren't involved politically, experience in the sense of their previous experience dealing with a particular problem and how they learn from that experience and so on. Experience in a more broad sense in terms of how the discourses of political culture, national identity within a particular unit can press upon and so on. And then this can be deployed and involved for various different purposes, to clarify options, to rule out options, to try to project forward or to prescribe different forms of action. That's a very good article if you're interested in, as I say, a kind of conventional sort of taxonomy of this. Now, of course, as I say, just because policymakers refer to the past when they're deliberating doesn't necessarily mean, of course, that therefore the past is kind of in some of the past as they construe it is therefore, you know, all you need to understand about politics and their political deliberations. There's a whole series of questions that of course, need to be asked. There's the question about the rhetoric versus reality kind of question, how far policymakers are simply referring to the past kind of purposes of mobilisation and legitimation, whereas in fact they're motivated, as far as I can tell, by other factors. Relatedly, there is the question of how these kinds of ideational factors interact with and fit with material factors in determining policy. There are issues about how this manifests itself, how explicitly this manifests itself, where there are cases where policymakers explicitly sit down and try to identify precedents which will be of use to them when deciding on action in a particular case. In other instances, this operates more kind of unconsciously. You can see in retrospect that their options were kind of constrained and formed by past experiences, but that wasn't kind of explicit in policymaking discourse and so on. So there are always these questions that need to be asked. The importance of memory in policymaking cannot simply be assumed, but the way in which both international historians and critical IR people have written about this lately does kind of develop this further than and others would take it, and kind of expands the frame of reference in a way by making memories of the past into part of the kind of cluster of constitutive cultural elements that really constitute the worldview of policymakers. So this takes us much further than the kind of Neustadt and May kind of attempt to sort of optimize the use of the past. Neustadt and May are saying, okay, yes, of course, policymakers use analogies. They just use them better by following our prescriptions and so on. This is a different kind of concern, because this is talking about how memory will make itself felt regardless of the kind of intentions and the consciousness of actors. And this links in really interesting ways, in ways that should, I think, be further developed, to really interesting work, again, both in international history and IR, about affect and about embodiments and about policymakers as kind of embodied human beings, and how that should change the way in which we think about how decision making operates. And the other key point about this new kind of thinking about decision making is the way in which it explicitly sees policymaking discourse as embedded in a wider memory culture. And you cannot divorce the way in which policymakers think about these issues in the narrow kind of chamber of policy deliberation from the way in which these issues manifest themselves in a wider context, the broader context of a memory culture, of political culture, and identity. And this is the second kind of frame, I think, in which memory is significant today in politics. The way in which memory is a crucial part of the fabric of political culture and national identity in many kinds of cases. great deal of the work in memory studies over the last 10, 20 years has taken the nation state as its kind of object of analysis, has kind of assumed that there is something significant about the nation in relation to memory, the memory of war, the memory of trauma, and so on. And of course, in some ways, this is perfectly understandable, because if you're talking about war, in some senses, that is, of course, an interstate phenomenon, so it's not surprising that working through the legacy and heritage of war should be something that nation states are interested in. By the same token, it's clear that governments, states, are very powerful actors in this kind of realm of symbolic politics, in the sense that they have both the means, institutionally and so on, and the interest, in terms of legitimation and so on, in managing understandings of the past, the various present-centered ideas and purposes. So the prominence of nation-framed work within memory studies is quite explicable, and this remains important, I would argue, even though, as I go on to say, the significance of the nation is much less often now taken as self-evident in relation to memory or any other aspect of politics. So national memory cultures, the way in which past experiences of historic trauma or indeed of the commission of historic crimes have been worked through, come to terms with, within different nations in order to achieve a whole range of political and cultural goals, to build legitimacy for particular regimes or particular political factions, and also simply to bind communities together in the aftermath of lacerating and dislocating historical experiences. And equally, scholars have looked at the massive range of kind of cultural activities and agents that have been involved in this kind of memory work, from a whole range of different spheres of activity, political rhetoric, educational curriculum, memorialising work, building of museums, representations of past traumas in all kinds of cultural forms, films, television, novels, and so on. So, you know, this is seen in retrospect now as, you know, an increasingly significant part of the building of political culture, the building of national identity, and this of course has political significance in terms of how states orientate themselves in the world and regimes orientate themselves in the world. Work here has become increasingly sophisticated. As I say, there is of course has long been a focus on state activity, government activity, elite kind of political activity to try to engineer memory, to try to engineer understandings of the past, both by promoting particular narratives and promoting recognition of particular historical events, and by encouraging silences and absences around particular kinds of issues. Painful, burdensome aspects of the past might be pushed to one side in order to restore national self-esteem, so on, and attention might be diverted to more heroic, more glamorous kind of aspects of the past. So it's well established that governments are interested in managing understandings of the past. But, of course, governments are not kind of totally sovereign over this process, are not able to simply impose understandings on a wider society. Their capacities are hedged by a whole series of different factors. They're hedged, for example, by the nature of historical experience. Government kind of memory projects have to resonate with people on some kind of level in relation to their lived experience, or they tend to fail and to be seen as failed. By the same token, government attempts to manipulate memory have to fit with the norms and the narrative resources that pre-exist in a particular culture. So you tend to find in particular cultures that particular kind of narrative templates, particular kinds of story resonate because they've been deployed politically in the past, and stories that, that fit with those kinds of narrative templates, those kinds of sorts of explanation tend to work best within a particular kind of society. But even then, thirdly, there is the fact of contestation, that memory, would-be memories are not simply passively consumed by the people that they're directed at, but often they are contested. Counter-memories are proposed, and there is then a field of contestation which emerges around which memories should be dominant within particular cultures and particular societies. So this is a complex process. It's not simply a case of government writing memory. But nonetheless, the outcome of this, or the existence of this field of forces of collective remembrance, both constrains and enables external action. And even if this is about simply about identity building and about, you know, establishing a national subjectivity, that will in turn have external political implications in terms of rendering certain kinds of actions feasible and thinkable, and rendering others beyond the pale. So in terms of formulating responses and formulating external kind of actions, the field of collective remembrance increasingly is seen as an important kind of factor that must be reckoned with in political analysis. Thirdly, international conflicts over memory. This, particularly, I would argue, in the post-Cold War world, for a range of reasons to do with geopolitical shifts, technological changes, normative changes, a whole series of kind of profound changes in the social and political world, international conflicts over memory have become much more salient, much more prominent in contemporary international politics. And this is where the historical perspective and contemporary analysis kind of comes together. I'm just going to talk about two examples here, which do kind of speak, I guess, I think, I hope, to both the rising powers kind of issue and the question of regional sort of constellations within the wider terrain of global politics. I'm just going to kind of describe these two cases and elucidate their significance in further discussion if that's of interest. The first of these is the so-called history wars in East Asia over Japanese war responsibility. So this is to say the massive series of disputes which are bound to flourish even more this year as we come to the 70th anniversary of the end of the Second World War. Dispute between Japan and her various East Asian neighbours, particularly China and South Korea, around the legacy and heritage of the war, about Japanese responsibility for the war, Japanese responsibility for particular crimes committed in the war, particularly issues like sexual slavery, sexual comfort women, and thirdly and relatedly, the kind of, as it were, second order question about, not just about Japan's responsibility for those things, but Japan's attitude towards its responsibility for those things, and particularly its the perceived reluctance of conservative official Japan to offer sufficiently fulsome and sufficiently sincere apologies for Japanese actions in the past. Why is this an issue now? Why has this become an issue in the post-colonial world? You need to look at what's going on within the different actors and at a wider context in order to understand this. First of all, looking at China, you need to understand how the so-called anti-Japanese war resistance has been increasingly instrumentalized in China since the 1980s and the post-Mao kind of reforms period, in the propagation of a new official nationalism. For decades after the war, the Chinese regime was not particularly interested in talking about the Second World War. It was much more interested in terms of its historical heritage in the Civil War, and for various reasons it was seeking better relations with Japan and therefore didn't see it as being in its interest to stir up memories and hatreds from the Second World War. This changed from the 1980s, and particularly from post-Tiananmen onwards, where the regime began to invest massively in cultivating a sense partly in just making the memory of the war more salient and remembering it in particular ways as a war against Japanese imperialism and Japanese atrocities, and as a war of national unity and of resistance to threatening outsiders, as part of the attempt to propagate a kind of new nationalism, to bind the nation together as it moved into new uncharted political terrain. And this was done, it wasn't just just about the Second World War, this was done in the wider context of this frame of the century of humiliation from the mid-19th century to the mid-20th century, which was seen as a negative exemplar for modern-day China. So in China, there is greater interest in remembering the Second World War in a particular way, and in drawing explicit lessons from the Second World War for China's contemporary international politics. That's met with a perceived continued recalcitrance on the part of official Japan for war responsibility. Since the end of the Cold War, there's been a whole series of apologies by Japan, but these have generally been regarded as insufficient by those at whom they are directed. And of course, those apologies have been constantly subject to undermining and the proliferation of kind of countervailing gestures by Japanese leaders, particularly now the Abe government. This Abe government, again, this is in play in a whole series of kind of ways, where the Abe government is seeking to reinterpret Article 9 of the Japanese Constitution, which is the sort of pacifist demilitarizing article, in order to allow Japan to play a more assertive role in contemporary international politics. And this depends upon a reinterpretation of Japan's role in the Second World War. So there's a clash between what's going on in China and what's going on in Japan. And this is in the context of post-Cold War regional integration in East Asia, economic, demographic, political, cultural, which has changed the stakes for all parties. It creates new opportunities for Japan's former victims to raise their voices, and it creates kind of vulnerabilities for Japan, that it has to heed these voices, even if it's not just going to agree with everything that's been said by its former enemies. So the way in which this process of regional integration has brought these countries closer together in diverse ways has also served to bring these history issues onto the terrain of politics. So there's a complex series of things kind of fitting together. The second example, which I'll try to go over this quite quickly, this is another kind of regional issue, a European issue, but the relationships between the European Union, between its Eastern European members, Poland and the Baltics particularly, and Russia, around these issues of symbolic politics, these issues of memory, and how these are generating clashes in international politics. Again, it's about the individual actors and about the context that brings them together. The European Union has been doing lots of things in the last 10-15 years to try to promote a kind of common European identity, a common historical identity. Again, the obvious reasons being to try to promote legitimacy, to try to promote a sense of cohesion, which has been sorely threatened by economic and other difficulties and factors. The promotion of Holocaust recognition as a kind of new foundation for the EU has been a key element in this, particularly in the early 2000s. the idea that subscribing to revulsion at genocide, and at the Holocaust in particular, is something that should bind Europe together. That that's something foundational about what Europe is and what it stands for as a normative power. So the EU played a key role in the whole Stockholm kind of process that led to the emergence of Holocaust Memorial Day as a global phenomenon, as we see today. So that's fine, okay? Holocaust recognition. However, this posed some difficulties and raised some resentment in Poland and the Baltic states, as they were candidate countries in the early 2000s and then after they entered the EU in 2004. Partly this is because there were historical sensitivities in Eastern Europe, in some of these Eastern European countries about issues of collaboration in the Holocaust, but more significantly because there was resentment at the prioritisation of the Holocaust as the ultimate symbol of suffering. And the resentment particularly was that this seemed to many in the East of Europe to displace the suffering that they'd experienced under communism from the kind of common European narrative. Where's the place for our suffering if you're going to make this the yardstick of historical experience? And hence you get the discourse of double genocide, this idea that emerges in the East that has been pushed very hard, that you know communist oppression should be placed on a par with Nazi oppression in terms of how we think about the 20th century and its most important events and legacies. So there's conflict between the EU and its and its Eastern members. But then thirdly, there's also a further conflict between those Eastern members and Russia in the East, as Putin since 2000 has explicitly revived in a modified form the communist era myth of the Great Patriotic War as a kind of good war myth, a war of anti-fascist liberation, a war that speaks to the purity and goodness of Russia, and both historically and therefore by extension in the present. And this sets up a really complex constellation of symbolic politics. Of course, this is massively resented by Poland and the Baltics, who don't see the Second World War, of course, as a war of liberation. But then there's a further awkwardness, because in some respects, the sort of dominant EU kind of good war discourse does kind of fit with the Russian sort of good war discourse, kind of over the heads of those in the East, and that has generated some difficulties. In 2010, for example, British troops participated in the V-Day parade in Moscow. So, symbolic politics, and this of course intermingles with security threats. This is not the only thing that's going on here, but it interacts in important ways with the threat that the Baltics and others feel from Russia. And what you see here are interlocking, overlapping communities and regions of memory. So regions of memory within which memory is contested, and other regions where there are kind of relatively common and homogenous memories confronting other kinds of communities. How this works, there are really interesting resources in the memory studies literature to draw on, which I've listed there. I won't talk about them now for reasons of time. Of course, they all speak to the way in which memory persists beyond living memory and the different ways and dynamics of memory in decades when living memory is no longer an issue. So this is my final realm of memory is the realm of the transnational memory. The national frame, as I said, has long kind of dominated the literature, but it's now, you know, clearly it's no longer sufficient. It's not irrelevant, but it's no longer sufficient. Particularly as we see, and particularly in the modern world, global memory flows and the global contestation of memory. One of the conceptual things which has been very prominent in memory studies in recent years is the notion of multi-directional memory. Okay? So the idea that instead of simply looking at how, for the sake of argument, the Second World War is remembered and with what political effects, you need to understand how the Second World War is remembered in a wider kind of terrain where other conflicts are also there competing for attention, and where the memory of different conflicts and different trauma kind of intersects, sometimes one displacing the other, but in other cases supercharging each other. Multidirectional memory, particularly originally, as it was coined, referred to the interesting intersections between the memory of wars of decolonization and the memory of the Holocaust, and how the two, in fact, in the 70s and 80s, kind of gave succor to each other. So this encourages a kind of broader geographical sort of frame of reference and also attention to the transnational. I'll just talk about these very quickly, because I don't want to go on too long. But this is a terrain that very much chimes with some things that we talked about yesterday in terms of global governance and so on. This is a terrain where we need to attend to the role of norms, the role of NGOs, and the role of other non-state actors, transnational activists. The emergence of a cosmopolitan Holocaust memory is crucial here. It's kind of discourse within which Holocaust memory is sacralized and held up as a totem, and yet that also calls for resistance, whereby the centrality and significance and importance of the Holocaust is challenged, even denied in various ways. But the emergence of that Holocaust memory is obviously intertwined with the articulation of broader discourses of human rights and so on. You can't kind of understand human rights, I don't think, without understanding its linkage to Holocaust memory. You can't reduce it to that, but more can you understand it without attending. Secondly, and relatedly, memory studies scholars have written about the emergence of a global public sphere whereby norms of reparation, apology, regret, and come to be powerfully established in ways that do constrain the activities of states, whereby there are global expectations about how states will respond to past atrocities and crimes, and there are kind of, you know, in this global public sphere, states are not free to simply take any attitude they like, but they will come activists and others. And then this role of non-state actors and activists is also crucial here. If you look at the campaign over the so-called Come for Women sexual slaves, wartime military sexual slaves of the Japanese, this is a quintessential example of transnational mobilization. Feminist women's groups from across the globe coalescing, drawing on political support from the United States and other powerful states in order to put pressure on the Japanese in all kinds of Japanese government, in all kinds of inventive ways. So there's a whole new sphere here of transnational activity, which is important. Does this amount to a global mnemonic order? Question mark. Well, I'm not really sure about that. For sure, there are certain norms that are pressing upon actors spaces, but by the same token, there is of course scope for resistance, scope for contestation, and resentment at efforts to kind of generalize about what we should attend to and how we should attend to it in terms of historical memory. Okay, I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Now this place, the conventional analysis of memory for my MPhil in Cambridge. So, but the interesting thing out of that was that I was looking at intervention, British and US intervention in the Balkans in the former Yugoslavia. And the interesting thing was that both in things that they have already written, but also in the interviews that I made, for policymakers, it was absolutely clear, and they hadn't thought about it in a deep way, but it was very clear that memory and some kind of history of the region played a major role in how we perceive the crisis and how we reacted to the crisis. And in fact, Richard Lowry basically said there was a wrong history of the region, basically saying that they always fought each other for centuries. Balkans, it's the place where Balkanization was kind of created. So it's you know, impossible to doesn't make any sense. And only when that wrong history was corrected by some historians and using against some kind of pressure, that was also a major factor in terms of making some kind of intervention possible. It was obviously relevant for that. But this is really interesting. I have basically two questions or comments that you may want to address later, because I want to also open things to everyone, open the floor. One is this idea of global but also maybe regional mnemonic order. So in a way, are you arguing, or do you think it makes sense that you have to have some kind of agreement or shared mnemonic order, which I think is a great term, for regions, for some kind of regional governance or global governance or regional institutions or global institutions to be able to function. If you don't have that, then that's not the second one is probably it's an attempt to be slightly more provocative. It's this idea of memory balancing. Because you know, Portugal committed the terrible atrocities throughout its centuries of imperial expansion. But nobody is too concerned with that. You know, we don't get lots of requests for apologies and probably because we don't have any money, that's not but also I was wondering whether it's this kind of darker side of soft power. So you have these great powers, regional or global, projecting a lot of soft power. And there is a kind of a balancing within that soft power sphere by namely pointing out, well, these very often great powers were imperial powers or used coercion, or this is now not accepted in international law. So you have to apologize, make some kind of gesture. And that is a way of trying to constrain, bind, and balance maybe the power of this great regional powers. So that's the comments. And then I would open the floor to you, maybe challenge it to think whether that this applies in your own field or your own subject, and it makes sense, or any other questions or comments. Yes.
So, thank you very much for your presentation. I remember very much that this is, I just have two questions. I am not at all specialist in this field. But it's very interesting. It's the first time I have heard some things that are very, very interesting. First one is the relation before. Why do you think it is emerging a kind of global memory idea like the global cosmopolitan whole house, and not emerging any kind of similar global gulag, for example. Okay? Did you understand? Global gulag. And the Soviet idea that this idea that is, there are a lot of societies that have had massive concentration camps. China during the Cultural Revolution, for example, or situations like it. Probably it's because the regime is basically emerging because of the Communist Party is power in China. But in any case, there are many, many cases of, let's say, left-wing Holocaust that didn't emerge. And this is related to the second question that is a lot related to even to my personal experience, and that is in relation to how in Argentina it was possible to create a new official memory that is inverting the previous one. So the whole all the bad things were produced by the military dictatorship and the leftist guerrilla that was extremely totalitarian in their mind changed the history saying they were fighting for the moments. Even in Brazil, for example, the present president of Brazil, Dilma Rousseff, was a member of an organization that was in favor of taking power for the dictator of the Britannian dictatorship. But now she says that this she was fighting for the moments, okay? And so, what is the general explanation for the difficulty in addressing the Western world of emerging the idea of massive violation of human rights in memory from the left, the same than from the right?
Yes. Thank you.
Well,
I think that's the question was more common on the topic. I find it very interesting the part about how memory is used in securitization issues and how the same memory can be used in total different ways. For example, when I take the German memory of the Second World War, of course, on the one hand, there was always a topic, never again a war platform.
what is collective memory? So what are the criteria that you find out? This is really the memory of the collective and not just of the politicians the politicians who are actually doing what they do, and because this is in the group. All my broader question is, how do you actually know who's the community who's thinking? Because there may be diverging discourses or diverging memories when we think about what happened in France 7 weeks ago when they were bombing Charlie Hebdo. People were saying on the streets, okay, I am Charlie. Well, is this the collective memory of total France, because I doubt that, because in France there are many, many people who actually say, no, I am not shy. And yeah, how do you research it, and how do you make sure that you say, okay, now this is with the collective memory, that seems to be like, I don't know, 90% of the people, or 50%.
That's the criteria.
I should be focusing on that.
I have a number of other questions. Maybe I'll ask him to answer this now, but is it directly?
It's because of the data stuff.
Okay.
I'm just going to just quickly go back to that, because I know you like to, I think it's very important to study collective memory and all that. But what I thought was interesting in one of your slides, I think, is between telephoric and versus reality. I just wondered, how do you differentiate between, and I guess it depends as well which theoretical approach you take and all that, and you outline that sort of stuff. But I think it's more for you guys who are actually thinking about doing it. Think about what do you want to capture. And then linking to Stefan's question, and because I think for you as a historian, you know, it's very clear that you went to archives and you collected, you know, or maybe you did something else. I'm interested to, and then Bruno, you were mentioning that you did something similar. But you did interviews. And I think, and I don't know how familiar you are with the social psychology literature, I mean, you mentioned some of the psychology literature. So, you know, there's a kind of debate between how do you study memory. And if you remember in Homburg, when we did the class, and I was talking about interviews and all the rest, but I wanted you to really think about the fact that if you ask policymakers how do they remember, or how what happened 10 years ago when they made a policy decision about X, Y, and what was the inspiring or leading that decision. Now, are you asking someone to remember 10 years ago what they've done? And there's a different side of it, but I just think you need to think about how you actually studied memory, and what are you actually studying when you're studying it? Are you really capturing that rhetorical device that people use because they want to remember something in a particular way, or the reality, you know? And if you're doing the kind of hypothesis way of doing your study, then you have to think about it very carefully. Because, as I said, the social psychology literature, there's a massive debate about, for example, using interviews in order to check for how people remember what decisions were made, how they made decisions 10 years ago.
Maybe I can help you with this. As many sources as possible, as many references, as cross-references of the how you study memory.
Shall I start with that, or shall I start with something else?
No, whatever you want.
Okay, I mean, I'll just select some things to talk about. The question about whether, Bruno's question about whether whether regions need a shared understanding of the past, or sort of regions and groups or whatever, need a shared understanding of the past in order to function, is of course a good one. As I constantly been saying, the significance of this kind of this phenomenon, you know, can never just be taken for granted, it has to be interrogated and so on. My response to that question would be, you know, if we look at the example of the EU, but certainly there does seem to have been a strong sense from some important kinds of actors within the EU that was necessary, that building legitimacy for the Union as it expands and also as it encountered tremendous difficulties with constitutions and so on, did require the kind of, you know, the soft power building that through the propagation of a kind of some kind of sense of common history and some kind of sense of common identity. So, and then that project was embarked on, but of course it created as many difficulties as it solved, because of course you then get into the question of okay, what should constitute this European history of memory? What are the key markers of references in here which talk about some of the controversies that this kind of set off. There is this tour of the battleground piece section at the bottom of it is identifies seven different kind of key issues in European memory, from the Holocaust to the Gulag to the memories of imperialism. And that's an attempt to be concise, and still you've got seven massive kinds of issues which somehow need to be fitted in. And this just shows that the problem with these kinds of projects is that they either grossly simplify to such an extent that they arouse massive resentment from people who feel excluded, or they become so unwieldy and complex that they can't really be usefully instrumentalised, because they just become a massive catalogue of historical stuff. Which is not possible for anybody to feel particularly emotionally kind of attached to. And leaving aside the fact that, as I talked about, the specific attempt to prioritise the Holocaust that generated direct reaction and this attempt to kind of set off the memory of the Gulag and the communism and deportations and so on against you can say that generates a kind of productive debate about the past and that these things should never be set in stone and so on and so on, and that's fine. But of course, if your concern is to try to produce a sort of relatively settled kind of set of understanding to the ground of a particular identity, then we're going to be in some difficulties. So, I mean, whether objectively regions do need to do this, I'm not really competent to say. What I'm interested in is the fact that in many cases, empirically, they do seem to feel this need and then go about doing things in response to that perceived need in ways that I think is worth interrogating. The question of the issue about why any kind of global memory of leftist atrocities has been much slower to emerge is, of course, a very germane and interesting one. And many issues are kind of adduced in trying to interrogate that kind of question. Often, much is made of the fact that it's still very difficult for kind of leftist inclined intellectuals in Western Europe to abandon their kind of emotional attachment to the left and to communism, and that has produced blinkers in terms of trying to really come to terms with that. I guess also there is something about this is not really an explanation, I don't think so much, but something about the fact that in a way it's easy to anathematize the Nazi Holocaust, because there's not really anybody serious who is kind of going to take a counter position to that. I mean, yes, there are of course some disturbing attempts to relativize the Holocaust and so on various far right fringes, but there isn't a kind of really powerful significant force or any kind of state that is kind of going to take a counter argument. Whereas it's more complicated in terms of leftist atrocities, because many existing states and regimes see themselves still as being kind of inheritors or following on from those regimes, and therefore they're not prepared to kind of just turn against that in the same kind of way. But I mean, I think there is definitely, this is an important aspect of debates in this area now is an attempt to take a measure much more seriously of Stalinist and Chinese communist and the atrocities and depression, and to try to locate that in relation to other things in a meaningful kind of way. It always generates this problem that people are often very resistant to being comfortable to talking about multiple potentially competing kind of things simultaneously. They fear that if we give more recognition to communist crimes, that by definition means less time will be spent addressing Nazi crimes, and that would be ethically kind of problematic. So the attempt to create a more capacious kind of landscape where these things can all be recognised constantly comes up against that kind of structural problem. That's not really a problem. The research kind of issues, there are several different aspects, I guess, in response to that. One is, you know, the point that you made, that this is another one, I didn't mention it on the side, this is another one of the problems with the term collective memory. It implies that there's a state of kind of collective which you're exploring in order to analyse its memory, whereas really, in most cases, what you're doing is trying to analyse precisely this kind of process of contestation and a kind of dynamic process which is never really settled or stable, where you can point to this collective has this particular memory, because any collective, even if it's united by one particular form of affiliation, it's cut through there by loads of other different forms of affiliation. So the nation is also cut through by race, class, gender, and religion, and so on. So the idea that there's end, you know, the more you look at it, the harder it is to actually find stable kind of memories, and hence you end up analysing the process of contestation. Precisely how you're more interested in the terms of the contestation than in anything kind of solid sort of real. So that's my fault for using the term collective memory, which does carry that kind of connotation. Be able to give a percentage of the collective which adheres to that particular sort of memory. Of course, it's all public. In terms of the more sort of methodological kind of sides of things, I mean, the kind of work I'm doing now is more about the sort of very recent past, the post-Cold War kind of past. It's not really kind of archival, it's very sort of open source really, because it's about public debates, it's about films, it's about television. Museums, memorials, commemorative events, particularly. So, and it's kind of it's large scale and sort of synthetic, rather than kind of looking at the real sort of nitty gritty of how these things are debated in particular policy making changes and so on. So some of those issues don't quite manifest themselves in what I'm working on now. Of course, it's. You know, there are lots of interesting and important questions that you need to ask if you're kind of looking at policy making deliberation and talking to policymakers about these things. And of course, these are the things that need to be carried out with tremendous care and then cross-checked with other kinds of sources. From my point of view, there's, you know, and quite a substantial literature on this, which breaks down the kind of public-private kind of dichotomy, whereby you can do the right kind of archival research and cross-check kind of sources. You know, it becomes significant if you can see policymakers kind of saying the same kinds of things in public and in private about historical precedents and historical analogies and so on. That kind of leads you to suspect or to conclude that, you know, there is something going on here that's not really equally, in terms of how I think about this, in a way, even if it is the case that policymakers are are simply kind of using this rhetorically, I still find that important and interesting because it suggests a certain sort of understanding about the wider terrain of political culture and identity and American culture to which they're speaking and which they're, you know, if they think that certain kinds of arguments are going to resonate, then that suggests that certain kinds of understandings are embedded or flourishing in the wider culture, which itself then is part of the what I'm kind of interested in. So in the sense that I'm not just interested in the policy makers but in the wider terrain. I simply try to use that as a kind of opportunity. Otherwise, yeah, I guess the things that you said, multiplicity of sources, so on, need to be taken into account.
So I have three questions in the left here. In the court.
Thank you, Patrick, for the presentation and also for these answers, because we spoke to the conversation. This is all about joining the conversation. It answers part of what I had in mind as a question, but I wanted to also get your response on the kind of sequence that seems to exist in the kind of working on collective memory. I took the short term after very sharp events, if you like, or very dramatic events. Would you relate all the issues that are under the research frame of transitional justice to collective memory? Because that seems to be the immediate response, and it seems to be now globally organized, if you like. So transitional justice as one first approach to settle some sort of memory in there. And then as it moves on, you mentioned in terms of contestation, it's really open to debates inside societies. And there's some larger narratives that seem to emerge and seem not to go away. What I find surprising, and why I'm interested in whether you see some pattern, a sense of continuity and change. Because when it comes to issues that are related to foreign policy, I find that many of the norms and the beliefs and the construction of the national perception, they seem to come along with a relatively large amount of continuity. Yes, they are challenged, and yes, there is some contestation from the outside and from the inside, but rather in comparison to domestic issues, these foreign policy issues seem to go with a longer stretch of continuity. And I wonder why that is, and whether there are some responses for it. And then I assume that in the selected further reading, you have several references to where I see the closest connection to the PRIMO topics, and would be, if you like, the collective memory of imperialism, colonialism, etc. Whether that provides some sense of community for the countries that were suffering from these events that are longer, a long time ago in most cases, that provide at least one basis for identifying across the BRICS, with the exception of Russia. And then in terms of what that means for respect and recognition and the sense of sovereignty and the sense of the right to ask certain things from those that were at least in the past responsible for these events, and I don't have to mention a whole school of post-colonialism to sort of study the continuity of these events. So I'm really interested in the sequence from the immediate response to these things and how that then develops over time and how that changes over, if it's a long-term memory type of thing like the colonial past.
Good question, actually, and thank you for the presentation. First, I was thinking how you think about memory in terms of as if it was like a useful tool for as an extension for current governments and politicians and so on. Do you also find it important to think of memory as, for example, like in game theory? You know what the other party did in the previous round, so actually. You make your decisions, next decisions according to that. So I mean, because we often tend to, I can often hear people talk about memory as if it was something very detached from what actually happened. So as if it was like a temporary tool, and it is changing, shifting, and so it's like something that contested ground. But on the other hand, a lot of people think about memory as a useful indicator of what to expect from certain sources in the future, and they do make decisions accordingly. So I think there's probably a continuum between the kind of cynical, that we very, very kind of practical approach to memory, and how we think about this. The other one would be the contestation itself. So is there a difference between certain groups within society or certain people in terms of their maintenance of memory? So for example, if you go to a small village or a big city, you will find different people who would react to the media, to history books, to different things in different ways. So for example, if you have a dominant majority narrative which changes, some people don't change with it. They still maintain their old narratives, their own old understanding, what they learned when they were younger or what they got from their parents and so on. Whereas other people start to change their approach, and then they become very much, to use a very, very ugly word, brainwashed, kind of. But other people don't do that. So how does this kind of conditioning stick and not stick? Do you have a view on that?
This question may really betray my great ignorance on this particular subject, but you made an allusion in your presentation to this memory studies as apparently an emerging disciplinary field on its own right. What are the major differences between this area in terms of methodology, epistemology, and more conventional history? Can you tell us something about it?
Just something that has to do with security studies and the idea of collective memory in mass media. You know, the idea that this in cognitive science is something about the bias of availability. So whatever was the latest event you have on something in your mind, or the one that caused you a greater emotional impact, or the one that you have more repetition or more material of, constructs your memory of the thing, and therefore your sense of risk, danger about that thing, which is an evolutionary trait, which is quite useful. But then several people, I mean, Bruce and I once did a good talk about this, but the idea that since mass media in the 1970s is global, then naturally things which are incredibly rare, like a plane crashing, go into the collective memory as, nobody's ever going to fly Malaysian Airlines anymore. Right? That's now the collective memory. And that is such a rare occurrence. It should not have made the cut for collective memory. It should not have now be an index of measuring danger, measuring risk, measuring securitization, etc. But it does become that because of the effect of the global media narrative on over-representing rare things into the mainstream, if you will, of collective memory. And I was wondering if you thought of this and the effect it's going to have.
Thanks for those stimulating questions. I'm trying to sort of take them in turn. I would agree that there is certainly a kind of sequence of change over time. Transitional justice process in the immediate post-conflict sort of judicial settlements, as it were, and then broader kind of social work, cultural work that goes on to try to promote reconciliation, punishment in reconciliation and reconciliation, is very much so a kind of first cut of establishing collective memory, although of course it does almost always kind of build on understandings and so on, which emerge in conflicts themselves. Hence, that has some sort of continuity, as you alluded to. And then over time, it is a very, even kind of looking back, there is this impulse post conflict to try to, even though of course it's a kind of artificial process, to try to provide some kind of initial full stop to both that. So in the interest of social reconstruction and psychological reconstruction. And that almost always involves understandings which are too, which come to be seen subsequently as too kind of simplistic, if only because partly because of the legal frame kind of is in some ways inimical to nuance and inconsistency or simplicity, and also, as I say, the urgency of the need for political and psychological reconstruction. And then that gets rethought subsequently as a broader array of actors and people who are keen to promote wider kind of interpretations.
It's a generation.
And generation, I mean, it depends on what kind of time frame you're sort of talking about, but typically generational change is very important. And almost always linked in ways that are complicated to broader political and social change. So the case of the Second World War, of course, called the 68 kind of generation, a proper post-war generation kind of emerging into maturity, leads to a whole series of kind of challenges to initial post-war kinds of understandings. You're, of course, also absolutely right to say that in relation to PRIMO kind of concerns, the heritage and legacy of imperialism and colonialism is crucially important in this kind of respect. Outside of China and Russia, I'm not on very firm ground in terms of the kind of angry issues that might be in play here. But this is another example of like as I alluded to, this kind of multi-directional magnet in the sense that West European kind of attempts to promote norms around the Second World War Holocaust kind of historical experience do meet this enormous resistance, sometimes explicitly articulated in the frame of post-colonialism, from other parts of the world, where of course the kind of legacy of both empire and often traumatic wars of decolonization post-1945 looms far larger in terms of shaping consciousness and shaping political priorities than the Second World War. There's some really interesting work, which Bruno mentioned here, on Southeast Asia and the way in which the different Southeast Asian countries, the Philippines, Indonesia, which were occupied by the Japanese in the Second World War, the very starkly contrasting ways in which the experience of Japanese occupation has been processed in those countries, in their kind of cultures. In some cases, it has become a really important cornerstone in national identity and so on, the experience of suffering at the hands of the Japanese. In other cases, it's almost entirely absent because the wars of decolonization seem much more significant as foundational moments. So there's no necessary. Of course, the way in which particular experiences come then to be understood very much depends on what happens. In the meantime, there are other things that happen that intervene there. But certainly, in terms of rising powers, one could make the case that we need to actually analyse it in the way that I have done. I would imagine that, you know, rising powers feel a particular sense of urgency to kind of make sense of themselves and their place in the world, and particularly to look back to the past for resources that bolster their claims to legitimacy, to capability, to be worthy of respect. And that's definitely all going on in China's discourses. The sort of questions about how certain forms of dominant memory kind of take in some, or would be dominant memory kind of take in some groups and don't take in others, is a really interesting one, which I can't really answer in a sort of generalised way, because I think it does just kind of depend on all the other variables that are in play. Why certain groups remain attached to kind of older understandings as new understandings seem to sort of flourish in the broader culture. I guess, you know, depends on the particular kind of political investments, the particular kind of social structure. in terms of what is memory studies, I mean, there are many of these kind of interdisciplinary fields, which of course is partly just about, again, the academic politics and getting recognition that if you can constitute yourself as a field with a journal called memory studies, which now exists, you know, then you sort of become, you gain greater legitimacy, you gain greater visibility. Memory studies is a kind of interdisciplinary field, but it certainly draws things from history, but it also draws lots of things from, and there are lots of different things going on within it. It draws stuff from media studies, it draws stuff from social psychology, it draws stuff from political science. The extent to which it actually is a coherent field is obviously open to question. And it, you know, many of the people that would say, yes, I'm a memory studies scholar, nonetheless are positioned in history departments or political studies departments. So the extent to which this really is a new discrete thing can, of course, be questioned. The mass medium and so on, I mean, I would just kind of agree with your point about the significance of that. This is one of the sort of post-Cold War changes which I see as really significant in terms of just promoting the greater visibility of memory issues and greater contestation of memory issues, because of course digital network technologies and, you know, new forms of multi-platform broadcasting and so on, these massively expand the scope for producing memories and for the consumption of memories in much more decentralized and diversified kinds of ways. So certainly the mass media is vitally important to the emergence of the greater salience of memory issues in politics and to the propagation of these new norms and the contestation of these norms and so on, which I kind of alluded to. It's fundamental.
Some of your questions about